Good day to you from ChemHelp ASAP. This video describes the discovery of M4205, also known as IDRX42. This compound is an inhibitor of KIT, a tyrosine kinase, for certain oncology indications. The video reports the discovery program of M4205 as described in a drug annotation article in the Journal of Medicinal Chemistry by scientists at Merck KGaA in Darmstadt, Germany. The citation is at the bottom of the screen, and a link to the article can be found in the video description. This video does not describe every aspect of the article. I have selected the parts I consider to be the highlights that best summarize the project and fit within the medicinal chemistry class that I teach. If you happen to be a scientist who worked on this project and are able to speak about the research, I would be very interested in interviewing you. The channel email address is in the video description. Let's start with KIT. KIT, often called c-KIT, is a class 3 receptor tyrosine kinase. The gene that encodes KIT can undergo mutations in exons 9 or 11 to generate a constitutively active receptor, meaning the receptor is in its on state without binding its endogenous ligand. These KIT mutations can lead to the formation of tumors. In fact, 85 to 90% of GISTs, which are gastrointestinal stromal tumors, have KIT mutations. Based on the correlation between KIT mutations and GISTs, inhibitors of mutated forms of KIT have been designed as a GIST treatment. The first KIT inhibitor developed was imatinib. Imatinib remains the standard of care first-line treatment for patients with GISTs that show KIT mutations. GISTs in patients tend to respond favorably to imatinib, with a 68% overall response rate, ORR, and a 24-month median progression-free survival, PFS. Unfortunately, even with treatment with imatinib, genes encoding KIT can undergo additional mutations that confer resistance to imatinib. Once additional mutations are detected, different KIT inhibitors are the best option for patients. These later treatments, even though they are targeted to advance KIT mutations, regardless have reduced patient benefit based on response and survival. Furthermore, the later drugs show higher toxicity. This situation describes an unmet medical need. A need for new KIT inhibitors for treating patients with advanced GISTs that are resistant to imatinib. So we have now described the drug program at Merck KGaA. The discovery team aimed to design a small molecule, orally available compound. The compound must inhibit KIT with potency against the specific gene mutations in exons 13, 14, and 17, 18 that give rise to imatinib resistance. Furthermore, the compound should be highly selective for KIT with minimal potency against other tyrosine kinases to ensure reduced toxicity. Let's now dive into the research program. The discovery program began with a screening campaign. The primary assay in the campaign was a biochemical inhibition assay with KIT V654A, which includes a key mutation on exon 13. Compounds were also tested for FLT3 inhibition. FLT3 is a kinase that is similar to KIT, and screening for FLT3 inhibition provided an early indication of selectivity. The screening collection was a library from European Lead Factory, a drug discovery venture that has a collection of over 500,000 compounds, although the Merck article does not specify the number of compounds that were screened. Compound 1 emerged as a very promising hit. It has a nice potency for KIT with an IC50 of 12 nanomolar and no observed inhibition of FLT3. The compound has an imidazolopyridine system as the core of the molecule. The 3 position of the core has this pyridine ring. Then there is a short linker to this aromatic group. If you expect the core to be more in the middle of the molecule, then just wait a bit. The core will get more substituents shortly. early in the program, the scientists were able to obtain a co-crystal of KIT, the unmutated wild-type form, bound to compound 2, which is identical to compound 1, except for the addition of this methyl group. The configuration in the stereocenter in 2 is not specified in the paper, but the bound form of 2 has the R configuration. The co-crystal is available in the protein databank as entry 7ZY6. Let's take a look at the target ligand interactions in the co-crystal. Here is a view of the co-crystal with compound 2 in the binding pocket of KIT. We'll look more closely at specific interactions, but I want to highlight that one end of compound 2 is close to the surface of the protein. This part of compound 2, which is the core structure, will provide opportunities for tuning the ADME properties as we get into lead optimization. We can strip away much of the protein and see specific target ligand interactions. The amino acids in the target are in white, and compound 2 is in gray. The dotted lines between the two structures represent likely intermolecular interactions. There are lots of lines, which is not surprising given the excellent early potency seen in this molecule. Let's again look at the imidazolopyridine core part of the structure, this piece over here. We seem to have a gap in the target structure over here, so this part of compound 2, this is what we call the core structure, may accept additional substitution. On the screen are just a few early compounds that the discovery team explored with the intent of improving potency and metabolic stability. So compound 1 had good potency but poor metabolic stability, as seen with the high intrinsic clearance based on human and mouse liver microsomal assays. The linker was identified as a cytometabolism, but any substitution on the linker reduced potency. Moving and adding nitrogens around the ring in the 3 position improved potency and somewhat helped metabolic stability, but also reduced solubility. Removal of the nitrogen from the aromatic substituent in compound 7 gave no negative impact on potency. For all compounds that we will see moving forward, the ring at the 3 position will have these 2 nitrogens, as seen in compound 3, and the aromatic ring on the right will be a simple benzene, as seen in compound 7, no nitrogens here. We will see changes to the pyrrolidine on the far right and new substituents on the core on the far left. We now have another series of analogs. These compounds were pulled from Table 4 in the paper. Table 4 has a lot of analogs, and I'm highlighting just 3 compounds to keep the story moving. The team settled on a pyrazole ring on the far right and focused on the 6th position of the core structure. Based on the columns in the table, the emphasis is now on proving ADME properties, such as membrane permeability and solubility. By varying the number of carbons, N, in this tether and the identity of the R group, the ADME properties could be tuned. Since we are modifying part of the structure away from the center of the binding pocket, potency across this series is relatively constant despite the large variations in structure. Metabolic stability in human hepatocytes is also fairly constant, at least among the compounds on this slide. The one property that dramatically improves in the bottom row compound, and this is compound 32, is solubility, which is critical for absorption. Are any properties worse? Why, yes, permeability is lower. The efflux ratio is much higher in compound 32. High efflux can reduce absorption. Another issue is hERG channel inhibition, a possible cardiovascular safety risk. Basic amines are often found in hERG active compounds, and this pyrrolidine R group is a quite basic amine. Despite these shortcomings, the discovery team moved forward with compound 32, an indication that maximizing solubility was a top priority. The preclinical PK of 32 was very promising across all four common species. Like many basic amines, 32 has a high volume of distribution, which contributes to a longer half-life. Perhaps most surprising is the relatively encouraging oral bioavailability. Compound 32 has a high efflux ratio, which can impair absorption. Efflux transporters, however, in some cases can be saturated, which minimizes the impact of efflux. That may be the situation with compound 32 because oral bioavailability is fine. Let's now look at some in vivo efficacy data. In one study, the researchers monitored the level of KIT phosphorylation. When KIT is active, it undergoes autophosphorylation at tyrosine 703, Y703. Monitoring the level of KIT phosphorylation is therefore an indication of KIT activity. The degree of phosphorylation in undosed mice established the 100% activity level. Mice with a 10 mg per kg dose of 32 showed lower levels of phosphorylation. Over time, as the compound was slowly cleared from the plasma, phosphorylation levels started to rise. A higher dose, 35 mg per kg, gave even lower reduction in phosphorylation, especially shortly after administration of the dose. The researchers were able to correlate phosphorylation levels to the plasma concentration of 32 to better understand the PK/PD of the inhibitor. Note that these numbers were estimated off of a chart, figure 3C in the paper, so these values may be off by a percent or two up or down. So compound 32 inhibits KIT autophosphorylation in vivo. Can compound 32 affect tumor growth? In another study, tumors were implanted in mice. The tumors were GIST 430654, a cell line with mutations for both increased constitutive activity and imatinib resistance. 18 days after implantation, the mice were treated as the tumor volumes in cubic millimeters were monitored for 28 days. In the vehicle group, the tumors steadily grew in volume as expected. In mice that were dosed once daily with 35 mg per kg of 32, the tumor shrank within a week and maintained a small volume for the remainder of the study. With the in vivo studies from this slide and the previous one, the discovery team had evidence of on-target activity and reduction of tumor volume. The preclinical safety data for compound 32 were fairly clean. In screening for activity against other kinases, the only kinase of concern was FLT3, which had been identified as a concern even at the initial screening stage. So this outcome is not completely surprising. Compound 32 had low affinity for common at-risk safety targets, and other forms of toxicity were low. Consistent with preclinical data, the human volume of distribution of 32 is predicted to be high and clearance low to give a long expected half-life. The anticipated daily dose in human was less than 300 milligrams. A consequence of the long half-life is that fluctuations in CP between doses will be minimized, and the Cmax of unbound drug was predicted to be 17 nanomolar. Based on this anticipated Cmax value, compound 32's activity on the Hurg channel was deemed to be acceptable, with a greater than 30-fold difference between Cmax and the Hurg IC50. Therefore, compound 32, also known as M4205 or IDRX42, has been advanced into early clinical trials for treatment of advanced GIST. At the time of this video, according to clinicaltrials.gov, the study is currently enrolling patients. Thank you for watching to the end of this drug discovery story on M4205, an orally administered KIT inhibitor. A link to the original JMedChem article is in the video description. Please consider subscribing to the channel, leaving a like, or making a comment. Take care.